I'm in the prayer mountain. We're going to have a meeting, how to walk with seriously traumatized people. Well, my desire this time would be to share with you not just some insights, but I'd like to see impartation.
Amen.
I'm in this last stretch of my life. And you see everyone in the auditorium, when the skaters, the Dutch skaters, you remember, they go and then they all, and they push out their last strength to pass the finish line. Well, I don't know when my finish line will be, but I do know I need to share, and more than that, I need to impart. And so if anyone is interested in it, then let's talk. Because that's what God has given me. That's why we also have a small group. I didn't want to have big advertisement. I just wanted to have people come who would be worthwhile to spend time with and who could share on. So, and the theme which I have today actually is how to walk with people who have been seriously traumatized. Because you need a total different approach than other forms of counseling. The other forms of counseling are all fine, but I have found that when you work with a person who has been deeply hurt, they hardly listen. You can talk, they can hear, but doesn't go anywhere. And so many people say, yes, well, I told him this and that, but he didn't do it. Well, you see, it's not telling. The Lord needs to create peace first. And I think of myself, when I was about 7 years old, 44, I'm born 37, nearly 78 now. It's crazy to even think about that. But, okay, I made an agreement with the Lord. I said, Lord, I'd like to become 92. Well, the Lord said, well, let's see. I guess we all have something to say about that, in the way how we live, what we do. And I try to take care of myself. But yes, there are situations. And one day I won't be here anymore. And then I hope that people have taken over the key of my ministry. And that's really the ability to listen, to be there with a person where they are, and to start looking at them where, from their point of view. See, what you think is not so important. But you need to come, where are they? What do they see? What does the Lord tell them? And how can you get into that? And God is the one who calls us as priests in this world to bless. A priest stands in between people and God. Most of the time we stand with people, talking about God, sharing about Him. Sometimes, and also in our worship, we talk to God about people. So there are different ways how you can take your position, but it's always that we can bless people, because that's what the Lord started to do out in Genesis 1. He said, yes, this is good. What I've created, that's great. That's fantastic. And so I've developed then an approach based on encouragement. And Dr. Gary Collins just recently wrote something on that on the website. He is phenomenal. He has been right from the beginning that you could start a personal website. He had his own website and he started. And he picks up things from left and right. And he summarized, he says, we really should encourage people. So I can talk long about it, but I had a bad start in life. I could not study because I was looking out of the windows to the clouds, making stories out of them and things like that. I mean, you need to listen to a teacher to get something. And I was there, but I wasn't there. And I have seen this so often with people who were seriously traumatized. They would often hear, but not hear. And so they could not change their thinking. They couldn't change their life. And later on I discovered that people need to change their life, but they can only do it when they experience that they are at peace. Doesn't have to be the peace of God, but they need to be inwardly quiet, calm. Then they can transfer what they think into behavior. Nowadays we get more and more kids who have much information here, but they can't transfer it in positive action. And so mentally they might be giants, but emotionally they might be kids and behave like kids. And with the violence growing in the schools, you can imagine what this does to our nations. The same is happening in Holland. So we also have schools now where they have to pass through to find out that they have no metal or anything with them. And so, well, someone has said, if the end of the world is there, you've got to come to Holland, because there everything happens 50 years later. But that was 50 years ago. Now we are at the top of the things which change. And so the peace of God became such an important issue for me. And that's what I really want to talk about. Now, last year I spoke very much about this wall of peace and how you can have this wall of peace around you when you tell your concerns, your needs, with thanksgiving to God. Philippians 4. When you tell that, then you start to experience the peace of God, but inside that wall there can still be problems. There can still be war. And that's sometimes confusing. Well, Lord, I know you're there, but I'm still restless. Yes, Theo, that's between you and me. And that was such a blessing that you can even counsel when you've had trouble in your own life. You just put Jesus Christ on. One good example of that is that when I... Once I had a very tough counseling day, and I had read in a book of Martin Luther, he had said, when you have much counseling to do, you need to get up early in the morning. So I got up very early in the morning. And I prayed, but that was the time that whatever I said, no effect. I had not the idea that I got through even through the ceiling. And so, finally frustrated, I went to my job. And I thank God that at that time I was so frustrated, I drove so fast and so wild. I thank God that he had some angels to protect me, and also some angels to put a hand on the eye of the policeman so I didn't get a ticket. And I got way too early on my job, where I would have a counseling. And I met the director. Now, I had worked with that man for about 6 years. And when he asked me to come to work with him, I had learned one management question. What are you afraid of when Theo is going to work in your organization? And that was really bingo. He talked for 45 minutes. He told me all his fears. And the result is that I kept that in mind. And so I had no problems with him, never. I could, lavender, sail through the rocks. And he was standing there at the gate and he asked me something. I reply, he asked me something again, and I've got my first quarrel. I went to my office, passed by the office of a colleague. He says, Theo, hey, come for a moment. He asked me something, I reply, he asked me something again. I've got a quarrel with him too. I see my secretary, I say, hey, listen, cancel everyone. I can't do any counseling today. She said, but number one is already there, he has seen you, what do I tell him? I said, give me 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. I went into my office and I said, help, Lord. And then God spoke. Theo, put Jesus on. They come for you, for me, they don't come for you. So I just put Jesus on. Like a priest, I put a rope on. I said, Lord, I put you on. Now they have to meet you. Now let me tell you, the day was not easy. But I got through. And a few weeks later, I meet number one again. He says, Theo, you remember me? I said, yes. He said, you know what happened when I came in? I said, no. He says, I walked into a cloud of peace. That was so healing. I don't know what you told me. See, whatever I had talked about, he didn't remember. He just sat there in the peace of God. And that was all he needed. So you can have a battle inside that wall. So please, when you feel that, says Lord, but you are there and you shine. Fast forward to Austria. I was telling about blessing and how our attitude of blessing can work. I told the doctor about it. He says, they have got such a hard time because the insurance wants that I not spend more than 7 or 8 minutes per client. And how can I do that? There are people, they need 20 minutes. So I told him, well, go 50 minutes earlier. Look at the list and say, Lord, which people should I give extra attention? The Lord knows what I use coming. Because in Holland you have to sign in before you come. But you have to call in or so, and so they have a list. And then you spend extra time with these people, the other people, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, they're okay. And you give 20 minutes if needed. He came back, he says, Theo, this is such a wonderful tool. I just pray, Lord, who? and they cross. Then there was a nurse. She said, "Theo, I have a tough job. One of my responsibilities is sitting with dying patients. And I'm not allowed to say a word about God. If I say one word, I get fired. And they're dying. What can I do?" So I said, "Hey, have you heard about blessing with your eyes?" "Yeah, how do I do that?" she said. "Well, you think a blessing and you look a person in the eyes, not staring, but quickly. You look a person in the eye, turn back, and again, in and out, yeah?" "Okay," she said. "No words, just think." "Yes." She came back and said, "That works." Well, I knew it worked, because not only because of my own experience, but also because they have found now in science that there are mirror neurons, and they have found four places now where there is in the brain there are mirror neurons, and these mirror neurons, they react to what you feel, what you want to say, if you're on the same wavelengths. So two people who love each other, they just have to look at each other and they transfer. Yeah? So she said, "I was sitting with a patient, he was dying, he was so restless, he moaned back and forth, and he hardly knew that I was there, and I just kept blessing him without words." And then suddenly he looked at me. Huh? He caught my eyes. And then she said, he calmed down. After some time, he got a quiet smile on his face. He started to breathe again, deeper. And very slowly, he left. She knew he was a Christian, but she couldn't say a word about God. So she said, "I think the Lord has pushed some buttons, and then he could just go and let go." So the peace of God is so important. And why is that so important with people who are seriously abused? You see, in powerful peace, we always first focus on Jesus. And then what the Lord showed me about 47 years ago now, he showed me that what happens in the brain when a person gets wounded, he showed me that then there comes a scar, and around the scar comes scar tissue, so that the scar doesn't bother so much the rest of the brain. That was very much in layman's terms, but later on, that's what actually scientists 20 years ago discovered when they had machines that they could actually look into the brain. But this was 47 years ago. God inspired me, and I obeyed, and the Lord said, "Theo, just bless the brain, just put your hand on the brain, and talk to the brain parts." And he showed me that the body remembers what the brain cannot remember. Your body knows what you can't recall. You see, when I would go through customs, I would be nervous. And I never understood why, because I had never anything with me. They always picked me out. Because they saw my body language. So I said, no, there is nothing. Okay, you look at. Well, when the Lord showed me this, that the body remembers, then I also started to understand what had happened to me and the uniform. You see, a soldier, a uniform. But I'd never put that together. A little Thai woman, once a year need to renew my labor permit. A little Thai woman in uniform. I had an attaché case and you could open them in two ways, in a good way and a bad way. If you opened it in a bad way, then everything fell on the floor, yeah? And so it should be 50-50, but by me it was always, nearly always, everything on the floor again. Okay. So, the body remembers what the brain cannot recall. And when people hear this, then they start looking. It says, "Yeah, well, I have also had some problems with this and with that. What has this to do with this or with that?" I always say, "Don't dig into the past, please. Let God bring things up. And when God brings things up, fine. Then you can look at it." And I have personally experienced that, Lord, when something came up, it was too hard to handle. See, one time I was supposed to speak somewhere, and just before that, I had a flashback. It really shook me. A flashback of something which had happened way before. I says, "Lord, I can't look at it now. Please, I give that back to you." God has made us as co-workers. And when we are not ready to face something, we don't have to face it. And that's so encouraging. Then you don't have to start digging. Yeah, I know that's a tough way, that area, but... And that set also my style. That when I ask people, when they ask me to, if I can help them, I say, "Well, can you give me a short outline of what your questions are?" And they give me, "Yeah, I've got this rotten situation, this and that and that." I says, "Okay, let me pray about it." And when you work with seriously traumatized people, I strongly encourage you not right away to say, "Yes, okay, let's make an appointment." Because you need to talk to God about it. Because once you say yes to a person, it could be a yes for 2 years or 3 years. And there are people who always want to be taught and never come to the acknowledgement of truth. Now, God knows that. And so sometimes, and I've had two or three times in my life that a person wiggled their way to the front of the queue, pulling strings, you see, that it could come sooner. And the Lord says, "No, Theo, I don't want you to really go into that." So I listen to them, half an hour, and several times I've said, the Lord told me right away, Theo, don't go into that. So I looked at this person with sadness in my eyes. I said, well, you really have a situation here. I don't think I can help you. They became so happy. I said, even Theo van der Weele can't help me. That's how big my problem is. See, some people glorify their problems. We don't want that. And don't get involved in that. So, don't dig into the past. Then the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all unrighteousness. What was done to us and what we did. But so many people have had terrible things done to them. And the blood of Jesus cleanses us. And there's one thing which I have, because I've been in different theological backgrounds and things like that, and for a time being an elder in a church responsible for counseling. And there were people who always were cutting the bond with the past. I break the bond with the past. I break the bond with your ancestors. And I never liked that. Because it's not only bad things which have happened. There's also good things. And so I think of one person who was sexually abused by her father. But he had some very interesting positive attitudes. In the sexual area he was weird, he was crooked, he was criminal. But he had an artistic streak, and I could bless that. Now the girl had simply said, I don't want to have anything to do with my father. And she had cut off, and her own attitude towards art, she had also cut it off. Well, I didn't know that. I just said, hey, listen, I've got an idea. There is an artistic streak in you. Does that make any sense? He said, yes, yes. Well, my father was like that, and since he has been so rotten, I've cut it all off. I said, hey, listen, let's ask Jesus to be a filter. Jesus knows what's good and what's bad. And the good let come through and let the bad stop. Then there is also, and I have a lot with that in Austria, the sins of the ancestors into the third and fourth generation. And there are many grandfathers who are at this moment now come close to death, and their kids have suffered under the sins of their grandfathers. Even if they were forced into the war, they were forced to do things which are horrible, and some of them decided not to. See, there was one father, his son told me, he had to, they were under attack by the Russians, and they had a group of people, and the lieutenant wanted to kill the Russians there. And so one soldier was sent out to throw a bomb, he was killed. Second soldier was thrown out, he was killed. And he was number three. He said, now you. So he put his gun and shot the lieutenant. So he lived. horrible things. People sometimes act intuitively, but he must have said, I won't do that. Yeah. So, and God also washes that. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from everything what has infiltrated us through generations. And there are feelings which are so strange. You can have had so strange ideas, certain thoughts, certain experiences. You say, where is that now coming from? We know now from genetics that there is also something like epigenetics, the atmosphere in which we grow up makes that some of our genes are activated, other genes not activated. Not all the genes which we have, and we have hundreds of them, thousands, they don't all work. But if you are in a situation where a gene is stimulated, like for instance, if you have a musical gene and your parents love music, and at a very early age already you can hit a tone on the piano as a little boy, and then they have a little violin and you can try and you like it, at a very early age that can actually develop that music gene also in this child. A pastor told me, Theo, we have adopted this girl, and it's very strange, when we say the name of Jesus, this girl starts to shake. And I said, come, let's look. He said the name of Jesus, and girl, 9 months old. Nothing conscious, nothing that she knew, she started to shake. I said, where does she come from? Well, her mom is a prostitute. I said, well, can we dedicate that child to the Lord now? Sure, he said. I got the child in my arms. I simply bless it in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I said, powers of darkness, you have no right in the body of this little girl. Leave. That's it. And the girl never shook anymore. Now she was 16, 17 years old. If she gets a negative friend, a friend who is morally a little bit loose, and this girl likes this loose friend, she could turn into a prostitute again. Because of the inheritance. Yeah? So, the Bible is still true. And I don't find any opposition between science and the Word of God. Truth is truth. Now, scientists have made now science a religion. And you've got to believe that this is the truth, not religion. No, we have proven this. But you see, there is no fixed proof. Something can show up, yes, 1 and 1 is 2. But at the moment I'm reading a book of a rocket specialist who is also a Christian. God and Rockets. And he proves that 1 and 1 is yes, it's 2, but sometimes it's 2.5. Just how you look at it. See? Issues in science are never fixed in concrete. We still don't know how light works. Is light a wavelength? or are they particles? Both is true. There are so many things. So I'm walking in the light of the Lord, the cover of God's light to shield us from attacks of our souls. They can attack our body, but they cannot attack or touch our souls when we are covered by the light of Jesus. Now, Jesus' body was not safe. He was hurt. He died for us. But they never could touch his soul. They never could touch his spirit. So the light of God is really for us a protection. And the Bible says that we will experience also much persecution. And I think it's getting more closer to it, even here in America. Yeah. One important element which I found in Powerful Peace is you need to bless the will. You see, and what do you bless in the will? Well, the bodily members. And the neck and the will, in any language where I've been, I've worked in about 40 different countries. In any country, there is an idiom about stiff-necked people or hard-necked people or something like that. But it's also... yeah. Good, huh?
You just hit a little button here.
Yes, I know.
I hated my husband.
Thank you.
Yes. See, so often when I need to bless a person, I ask them, can I touch your neck? And then I put my hand there, but there goes a whole other question. Before I ever talk about touching, you need to ask other questions. I come to that space later. But there is something in the neck. And you can bless people what they do not want. Last weekend, 2 weekends ago in Austria, before I came here, I had a weekend and a person came for personal counseling after the weekend. I said, what don't you want to happen? Huh? What don't I want to happen? Had never considered that. See, sometimes you need to ask them that. What don't you want to happen when I pray? And then you can ask, what do you want now? You can bless that. And then, what does one want for the future? Three different perspectives, you see. But bless the will. And you need lots of wisdom. And the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the awe for God. We need to realize that God is awesome. Yeah. And when we look at God, He says, Lord, you are awesome. And you keep that in mind. Then wisdom can grow, because you need to know how to use wisdom. It's not just having wisdom. It's also that you need to actually Lord, when do I use this wisdom now? God might have given you wisdom, but what do you do with it? Because it can be that your operation succeeds, but the patient died. You've done a perfect job. Everything was okay. They can check it out. But the patient did not survive. And that is also in counseling so. And I've been so often in situations where to do first aid to bring a person back to life because the heart, they nearly died in counseling. I had to bless their will. One beautiful example is a co-worker of mine. I was also in that Pentecostal conference, and there were about 20,000 people together there in Holland with Pentecost. That's an ongoing thing. We have that once a year. It's wonderful. And a lady said in the meeting, and totally unexpected, the Lord pulled the curtain. And she suddenly realized there wasn't even anyone speaking about sexual abuse, but suddenly she realized, but that's what my dad did. She had completely cut it off. So she didn't remember. So she started to cry. And then she said, well, I better go to the counseling tent because there are people who can help me. And there were two men sitting there. Oh yeah, they are men. Okay, well, they sit there in the name of the Lord. Let me go there. And so she walked over and she wanted to talk. But you see, she was a bit hesitant. And so they had all folding chairs. So she was sitting on the edge of a folding chair. And then the chair collapsed and she fell on the floor. One man stood up and said, Satan, I put my foot on you. At that time, a co-worker of mine, the Lord had told her, go to the counseling tent now. And she saw this man still. And she rushed to him. He says, get away, all of you, Obo, go get away. And the lady was still laying there in the grass. And she gave her a hand. She said, it's about time that you get angry. She lifted her up. And she could bless her anger. She was so angry, you see. She was so angry with her dad. But she couldn't bring out a word to these men. So she fell. These men registered anger. And the woman fell. So, okay. That must be demonic. Be very careful in that realm. With traumatized people, demons is the last thing you talk about. You turn on the light. Then the darkness goes. You might quietly say, powers of darkness, I don't want you here. But if that's not good for the patient to hear, then don't say it, please. We turn on the light of Jesus. Amen. Yeah? Okay. Well, let's have a short break, huh? The need for trust is so important. Whatever you do, remember that trust comes on foot and leaves on horseback.
Oh, that's good.
Say that again. Yeah.
That's good.
It's a Dutch idiom.
Yeah. Can you repeat it?
Trust comes on foot and leaves on horseback. And when you make a mistake, you simply have to accept it, you have to admit it, you have to ask for forgiveness, but the consequence is that for a long time people will not trust you. And so be open about it, so that people are warned. But when you tell them, yes, I've made a mistake here, and or in a situation, and I really blew it, when you are open about it, people can forgive. And then they know you won't do it easily a second time. And so confidentiality is so important. And so all the stories I tell are composites. Part of it happened with this person, another part happened with another person. All the stories are true, but you can't locate it back. Especially when we are recording it. Yes? Yeah. Unless a person is willing to admit it and say it's okay. And one of the things when I learned to drive a car, I need to learn to brake before I could drive. So he says, okay, let's get in. What do you do first? Yeah, I say, the key, no, first the belt. You know how we often start to drive and then driving still put the belt in?
I don't do that.
Yeah? So, and then he says, okay, now we go a few meters, stop. Okay, again, until I knew how to push the brake automatically rather than gas pedal. Because this is why sometimes a car gets into water or so in a harbor. Yes, and so you need to know when to stop. When do you stop a tough counseling session? Very simply, when you experience, I need to stop, you stop. Never mind, but I still need to talk about this, about that, or that. Listen, I sense it's good to be that we need to take a break now, and let's make a new appointment. Then you have got time to pray. And when the Lord says, no, this person goes beyond your capacity now, or they have changed their question and they want to go much deeper than you can go with them. Because sometimes a person has suggested something, but then there come some other things to it, and the Lord says, I don't want you to touch that. I've had that too. Then you need to say, well, thank you so much that you have really shared what is on your heart. But can we find together another counselor or specialist, and I go along. So please find people who know more about your clients than you. So when you hit such a person, a situation, that you can say, okay, I know a counselor who could do this. And you have talked to that person ahead of time. If I have a case which is very difficult, and I come at my borders, are you willing then to take over? If he's a professional, he will say yes. Okay, and I come along then. If he says no, I don't want that, then you need to be very careful. But when you say, listen, this client is so sensitive and I can work as a protection for her, because she was abused by a man and you are a man, and talking to you one-to-one, that doesn't go, it doesn't work. So can I come along? I won't say a thing, I will just make notes. And you get the notes, and I send a copy to the client, so then you know what you have said. Because when I have a session and someone makes notes, I want the client to read those notes. Why? Because they are often so amazed. Did he say that? I didn't hear a thing of that. But you heard it. You see, clients who are abused are often not there. So they don't listen. And when you notice that they don't listen, then you don't stop talking, because then they become self-conscious. You just keep talking and repeat again. And so you have said 10 sentences and you say it all over again, and he's still staring blank at you. You might even do it 3 times. And your assistant can then write down, yeah? And you can then quietly give them a chance to come back. One possibility, what you could say is, I understand this is really going deep. I would like at this moment now a 3-minute break, okay? Can we just sit quietly? And you give them time to recollect, time to work it over, because you have said some very important things and they can't listen because they need to work that through. That has especially to do when there's a problem in a very early age. I have a good example of that. There was one, I was in one country, and one girl had been severely abused by her father over many years. And she was finally, when she was out of the home, she could somehow stay away from her dad, and then it went better with her. But she was so angry. And these bones here were all fused. They had made an X-ray, and there was no space in between those lower bones. Her anger was so deep, and it got so on her muscles, had pushed all these bones together in constant anger. But she couldn't stop it. So she needed a corset. So one day she had told me, and I had asked her, why do you have the corset and things like that? And then slowly the story came about. She says, could you bless me? I said, sure. And I asked the wife of the pastor, her pastor, if she could be my second person, because I was visiting that country and I didn't have my regular assistant with me. And the lady says, sure. So I said, by the way, could you kneel by chairs so I have a chance then to touch your lower back or hold my hand there? I mean, she had already gotten used to the fact that sometimes people could touch certain body parts, and that was okay for her, no problem. And so she said, sure. So she knelt by a stool. I put my hand on her back, and I suddenly experienced the power of God going through my hands. And she said, Theo, is it okay if I lay down? I said, sure, go ahead. So she pushed his chair away and she lay flat on her belly. And I could just bless her. And then the power of God started to move through her spine, up and down. I could just see it. I looked at the pastor's wife and say, see? Yes. She said, wow. I said, call your husband. So the husband came. He shook his head and left again. This is the only time that I prayed, I think, 2 hours and 50 minutes. Normally, it's I stop with talking after 1 hour and 50 minutes counseling. That's usually the length of my time. But prayer, it can, if it takes up to an hour, okay. But there has to come, you have to come to an end. You don't want the client to go too deep into needs or problems. Now, if they are okay, fine. If they can handle it, fine. But this was going on, and as long as the Lord was working like that, I said, okay, Lord. But after this 2 hours and 50 minutes of prayer, her back was totally healed. She didn't need to carry a corset anymore. The bones were again out of each other, and somehow the Lord has the suppressed soft tissue, I don't know how you call it in English, the cartilage or what, yeah, it had come up again and it was normal. So you can do that, but be careful when you set a time on how long you want to pray. Only in very special occasions do I go longer than 1.5 hours or so. 1 hour, 50 minutes, that's usually my maximum. Now, the body needs the touch of the Holy Spirit. How does that work? God can work through your words, through your voice. And the person experiences something inside. You don't see anything, but God works in mysterious ways, inside the person. Yeah? And she has different books, but the body remembers case book, and Help for Helpers are excellent books. You can just use them. And they are such a good training. But sometimes I pray with women and I know there is something wrong in the sexual area, but I can't talk about that. I couldn't talk about sexuality in Thailand at all. I worked there 12 years as a missionary, but I couldn't say anything even to a man about sexuality. You don't do that. So what can you do? So I prayed in Thailand, Lord, come with your peace. And start working from her hair to her feet and everything in between. And I let him say, take some time for it. Let the peace of God work in your brain. And when the sun shows up, some dark spots, okay, just says, Lord, I give that to you. Because Jesus cleans, you can't. So go there, and you go down your chest, down your belly, down your feet, everything. Let the Lord clean it. And so many people have become healed. The first person whoever came in a session where I gave a demonstration. It's actually the first time I spoke publicly about sexual abuse in Thailand was in Christchurch, an Anglican church in Bangkok, and a missionary had, and it was announced that it was on the area of sexual abuse, and church was pitiful, and a missionary had waited for me when I came into the church and said, "Theo, if you want a guinea pig, you can use me." So very confidently at some time I said, "Okay, now I'd like to show you how I pray. And is there someone who would like to have prayer?" A tiny Thai woman jumps up and runs forward. Now, that's Thai women never do that. But she did, and there was a Thai pastor there who said, "Theo, I became so angry. Theo, you can't do that in public here. We don't do that. This is Thailand." I said, I closed my eyes. Didn't want to see it. But then I heard you pray, and I said, "Well, that's not too bad." Then I opened it up, and I saw what you did. You had a lady 1.5 meter away from you, kneeling by a chair, and you were just sitting in your chair. And you were just coaching her through a light shower. Let the light of God go through her body from top to toe. And it was so simple. "Lord, please come with your peace and touch her." And I had let her kneel next to a chair. She dutifully went on her knees, and I told her, "No, not on your knees, just sit on the side of your legs, because it might otherwise start to hurt too much." And so she relaxed and says, "Okay, we go to the peace of God." And she reacted. She really was relaxed. So now we go to a little bit of pain. And I saw her face twist, you see. And so after 15 seconds I said, "We go back to peace." She was again relaxed. Now we go to a little bit of pain. After 30 seconds, I said, "We go back to peace." In 45 minutes, this woman got totally healed. What was the story? I heard that later. As a young girl, she was growing up in the jungle, and there was no medical center there. There was only a spirit doctor. And she had physical problems, so she went to the physical, to the spirit doctor, and said, "Yes, well, you've got to undress." So she undressed, and she sat there. He says, "Just lay back." Then he raped her. She was 16. He says, "You need to come 2 or 3 more times back, and then you will be healed." But she took off. She even didn't tell her parents. She just said, "I want to go to Bangkok." And there she found a Christian lady who had a restaurant. And that lady took her in as a worker. And that lady brought her to Jesus. And this lady had heard about the meeting. And the lady had taken her along to this meeting. So she jumped up and ran forward. And this girl went through a whole series of deep touches. And after 45 minutes, that's the only time that one woman in 45 minutes got totally healed from sexual abuse, and that was it. Later follow up, everything was fine then. So, but Lord also knew that I was leaving the next day for Holland. See, I had very strategically planned it the day before I left. The day after, I would be gone, so I wouldn't get all the all the flak, you see, all the shooting at me. Because I didn't know how the town would react to this, how the churches would react to this. So, whatever happens, stay in control. When you don't feel that you have control anymore about what happens, stop it. How can you stop a person manifesting? Simply talk in a normal voice and say, hey, listen, I'd like you to drink a little bit from this glass of water. Whatever you see, I think you need to drink now a little bit. Drinking is one of the first things a baby does. And allowing them to drink has a soothing effect. Then you say, okay, can you change body position? So if they're standing, say, could you just sit down for a moment? And in this way, you can help them to come back in touch with reality. Yeah. Then you can ask them, okay, now you're breathing rather irregular. Can we now follow? Can you follow my breathing for a moment? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Hold. And they do that 3 times. And have not once had seen a person who did not respond to that. Never mind whatever they manifested. Glass of water, body movement changing, and breathing. Now on page 4 you see the culture of abuse. We discussed this partly last year. If you want to know more about it, I strongly advise you to read my book From Shame to Peace, and there you find it very much in more detail worked out. So there you get some more information. But there is a survival lifestyle. And that lifestyle has kept them alive, because they still are alive, you see. So don't blame them, because that lifestyle, that egocentricness, or that unwillingness to listen, whatever they do, has kept them alive. So you can bless the culture of abuse. You can bless the positive sides of it. They have grown up in a dysfunctional relationship. And the dysfunctional relationship can be easily explained as abuser, victim, helper. And that's how they grow up. An abuser has always a victim. And a victim always needs an abuser, by the way. It's amazing how victims marry abusers. They're looking for it, because that's what they know. And a victim needs an helper. But the helper in this dysfunctional setting is also part of the system. How can we break this system? That's so difficult. The only thing I know, because in the world they tell, you've got to become an abuser by announcing that he has done that, And then the abuser becomes a poor man. I've always paid for that girl, I've done that, and now she's going to the police. And then he becomes the victim. And in the world, the only way out of this triangle is by becoming an abuser. But there is an other triangle. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And a person living in a dysfunctional setting needs to live out from the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Like I think of a Hindu family which was so destitute they didn't have any food anymore. And one morning, as there was no food, father said, "Kids, it's time for breakfast." And he dedicated his whole family to the Lord and he said, "Lord Jesus, if this is the time that we as a family have to come to you, I'm ready. If we need to die from hunger, I'm ready." His neighbor was a Hindu, heard his prayer. He quietly took a pail of milk and set it around the corner, and dad was still praying. And one of his sons was opening his eyes. And father said, "But dad, something is standing there." Dad looked, and then they could live again. And from one thing came the other. And the family is still alive. Because father believed God. But he was ready to die. So, this triangle is so important. And actually, this is how through Christian marriages or heathen marrying Christian wives, how they've converted sometimes whole tribes. Because when a chief of a tribe married a Christian girl and the Christian girl did what the Bible told her to do, the man could only become Christian. Because the whole quality, the behavior of a Christian woman, when you even think about Proverbs 31, you see that wonderful song about the Christian woman, the biblical woman, that is so opposite as to anything in the heathen world. So, yeah, sometimes I tell women when they come to me about their, but I have also needs and also desires. I said, when you behave like the Bible says you should behave, see what is going to happen. Don't talk about, but my husband should change here or my husband should change that. No, you behave as God wants you to behave. And one of the biggest problems is that women so long still have the idea that they can change their husband. And it just doesn't work because the husband feels it. Feels there's a pressure. She needs to lean backwards because the door to the heart goes open to the outside. And the harder you push against that door, the more difficult it is for him to open it. But when she leans backwards, she steps backward, then he can open the door.